Welcome to Blockbusting, the podcast where we love to hate the movies. I'm your host, Jay Light. Joining me digitally today, Paige Wesley.
Hello.
Paige, it's good to see you.
Good to see you too. It's been a while.
Yeah. How long has it been? When was the last, I guess probably roast battle, which was
probably
ages ago, it feels like.
Yeah, I think I saw you a little bit after that, but it's been easily, I haven't seen you since quarantine for sure. So at least 2 months.
It's crazy. Yeah. How's your quarantine going? You doing all right over there?
We're doing great. And I feel bad because almost no one else is, but like we're having a pretty good time.
I got to tell you, when I heard that they were extending it for 3 more months, I was relieved because like I've gotten into a good groove. Of like making stuff and working on things and having to go back to like a regular job right now would just disrupt all of that. And I'm just like, you know what? I'm just going to coast on this for a bit. I got my unemployment. I got my PPP loan. I'm set. I'm good. I can make things.
Know. Yeah. I work from home or have been as far as this goes. My job went remote, like literally before they announced quarantine. And so I'm kind of in a normal day-to-day routine now, and we have a garden. We bake bread. It's great.
Man.
No arguments here.
This is just great. This is how life should be, at least until we can go out and perform live again.
Yeah.
That's the only thing I miss, and it's all gravy. We're working it out. Because we still get I still get to watch movies, and I get to watch a lot more movies now, and especially, you know, for the podcast, I'm watching a lot of movies anyway. And I've gotten to a point now where I start to, whenever somebody tells me a movie that they want to do for the podcast, it's harder for me to look at it objectively. And when I first heard that you wanted to talk to me about Mamma Mia, I was a little, what's the word? I guess I was hesitant to give it the benefit of the doubt.
Yeah, well, understandably, because there's a lot of pieces in it that should make it a good movie.
Right.
But, you know, that's not what happened.
So. Well, this is the thing, though, is like my hesitance comes from the fact that I'm not a huge, huge fan of movie musicals. I find that they're a hard thing to do well.
Yeah.
And I'll say that Mamma Mia doesn't do it extremely well. Like Mamma Mia is not a 5-star musical romp, but gosh darn it, I had a good time watching Mamma Mia. It's a fun time at the movies. Certifiable.
Yeah, well, I think a lot of that comes from the fact that it's ABBA music, which is undeniably catchy. And there's no way you can go wrong with that, except unless you have Meryl Streep sing it, which is exactly what they did. So, like, that's one of the big ways they go wrong, I think, casting people who cannot sing and dance to sing and dance.
But we're getting into the disagreements, because this is where I didn't even mind. Meryl Streep, to me, is... She's great in this because we never get to see in any movie, in the entirety of me watching Meryl Streep movies, I've never seen a movie where Meryl Streep gets to have fun. Meryl Streep is always so like sad and dour and serious. And in this one, Meryl Streep gets to talk about like fucking a bunch when she was in her 20s.
Yeah, and being in a disco band, okay, full disclosure. So I saw this as a play. As a child.
Okay, you saw the original version.
I saw the original version, which is essentially this movie if everyone was the best singer and dancer possible.
Right.
So, like, it's the best version of what it could be. And it still has a paternity test-sized hole in the middle of the plot, which has bugged me forever.
Right.
But the problem with it is, on one hand, all the women in this movie are supposed to have been in a disco band together in the 70s, and then it's set in the late 90s, which would have been basically modern day at the time that it came out.
Right.
And it requires being set modern day for the plot, because she has to track down all these men that she believes to be her father, which would require the internet.
Yep.
But it posits that in this situation where it is definitely, definitively in modern day, that they didn't think to have a paternity test. And that drives me insane. So, like, I cannot get over it.
It's very interesting that this is the one logical leap that you are not happy with. Because I get that. I was, like, watching this and I was like, I mean, they could just get a paternity test. But it totally...
Right, immediately.
But getting a paternity test would totally derail the entire rest of the actual plot. If they got a paternity test, this musical, this movie would not exist. And then we don't get the joy.
For the best.
No. We need... I never thought I would say this ever. We need Mamma Mia to exist. We need We needed the 1999 musical to come out, and then we needed a 2008 adaptation of that musical.
So here is my proposal to fix Mamma Mia.
Hit me with it.
Just set it 20 years earlier. So modern day is the 70s.
Okay.
Because then they don't have paternity tests, and it's not an issue. And then the mom's band is just like a 60s girl group, like a late 50s, early 60s girl group. And then we've got like modern ABBA disco in the 70s.
So I mean,
I have no problem with that version.
We're jumping ahead here a little bit. But remember, we were talking yesterday when I was watching the movie. And I was asking you if you were talking about the original or the sequel that you wanted to talk about.
Right.
Do you know what the plot of the sequel is?
I have never seen the sequel.
The plot of the sequel
is it basically what I just described?
It's what you just said. It's half prequel set in the 70s with Meryl Streep and company being played by, I think Lily James plays young Meryl Streep, and they have a whole bunch of other people playing the cast of the old folks in the 70s. And then it's like half prequel and then half actual sequel where they're like, well, we are back on this island and we have kids now and we have to figure out what to do. Mm. And Amanda Seyfried and Dominic Cooper have kids.
See, it bums me out because I think Amanda Seyfried is actually legitimately good in this movie. And I think she's one of the few people that really pulls it off. She can sing all of it. Dominic Cooper, not so much. And it pains me because I love Dominic Cooper.
Right.
But I think this might be his worst film.
He's pretty bad in it.
Pretty aggressively bad.
But I mean, I would never have guessed that I would watch Mamma Mia and enjoy it. Do you remember the first time so you saw the musical? And then
I saw the musical. I was probably about 11 or 12.
Okay. And then did you see... Yeah. Mamma Mia, the film, when it was in theaters?
I did not see it in theaters because I was like, I've seen the musical. I think I'm good.
Okay.
And then I saw Dominic Cooper in, I want to say in Education, which is like 10 years later almost.
Mm-hmm.
And was like, oh, that's right. He was in Mamma Mia. I should go back and watch it. And then went back and watched it and was like, man, like this is exactly like the play, except not as good as the play.
Interest, because now, man, it's so... Did you have this... Were you watching it by yourself? Were you watching it with anyone else? Do you remember what the experience was like of rewatching this? The musical version, I mean. The movie version?
The movie version, I definitely watched by myself. And I know I have a lot of girlfriends who love this movie. Mm-hmm. And think that there's absolutely nothing wrong with it. I watched the play with my family, and I will say, in watching the play, I was not as bothered by the paternity test.
Right.
And I don't know why, because they are nearly identical. Like, they really did do almost a shot-for-shot adaptation. There's not much change at all.
Right.
And I think, for me, where the play succeeds is that it's so fun, everyone's so talented, you love all these songs, it doesn't... Like, you get carried away with it. And I think that's what the movie tries to do. And I think where they fall short is literally the talent of some of the people that they have singing and dancing. That is one of my biggest issues with the movie, is that there are a million and a half dudes that could sing these pop songs. Because it's literally just pop songs.
Yeah.
And they cast a bunch of people who couldn't.
Iconic pop songs.
Yes, iconic pop songs that are, like, great songs and very singable and very enjoyable. And then you're sitting through it and they're having Meryl Streep sing a cappella at one point. And I'm like, guys, auto-tune this shit. Like, something. It is difficult and painful to watch occasionally when they leave in portions where people are just hitting a note flat. And you're just like, how... They did sound design. Like, they had every opportunity to fix this. Like, even if they had to cast those people, they could fix it. Mm-hmm. Like, there are things they could do on the back end. They could just play the ABBA songs over it. No one would question it. Singing in the Rain, that shit.
They could, you know? Yeah, like, they could Disney musical it where they redo someone's voice. They dub it over.
Absolutely. And no one would even think badly about it because it would be so enjoyable. They wouldn't care. They did that for Bohemian Rhapsody and then he won an Oscar. So like, I don't know why they didn't do that here.
Yeah. Meryl Streep would probably be totally okay with it.
Yeah. I don't think she would care at all, except then they went on and cast her in Into the Woods, which is such a difficult part to sing. And like, Bernadette Peters is still alive. Like, why did we do this? I'm a musical fan, but movie musicals are difficult for me for, I think, this specific reason, is that we have a tendency to cast people who are good on screen and good actors and expect them to do everything.
Right.
You know, like, Meryl Streep's not a singer. Yeah. Don't make her sing.
That's the thing with being a musical actor, it requires a very different skill set than being just a stage actor or a screen actor. Musicals, absolutely, you have to be able to sing and do all of the other acting stuff on top of it. Now, like I said, I don't mind that Meryl Streep's not the greatest singer and she just went with whatever she got, because I love getting to see Meryl Streep flop around on the roof of a hotel and almost fall through and just like have fun, because I never see Meryl Streep like that. It's like Meryl Streep being your fun drunk aunt, which is basically the whole plot of the movie. She's hanging out with her fun drunk aunts again. But
yeah, which that part I think works really well. I think the worst of it is when you get to the dads.
Yeah. But and that's the thing.
Not a one of them.
Because they can't sit, but the dads are fun. It's interesting casting choices.
Yeah.
Like, who would have thought casting Stellan Skarsgård as like any sort of romantic interest at all? It's such a weird, out of there choice.
Why they did it? I don't know.
But
why.
I love it.
Love Stellan Skarsgård, and he's not bad in this, except when he has to sing. Mm-hmm. But like, because I mean, as far as the character itself goes, I think if we removed the songs, all of the dads are totally fine in the character that they're portraying.
Right.
There's nothing inherently wrong with them. I think the problem comes when they try to sing, and specifically in the play, they actually have more songs. Like, they cut it back for the movie. I think because they're like, we can't sit through a solo from each of these people. Like,
right. Yeah. You can't
have their own song. Yeah.
We don't have time for that. So let's go into, I want to see how they marketed this, because the trailers for me are always a very interesting thing to see. Because I have a feeling they're going to highlight only the people who can sing well. Like, they're going to highlight Amanda Seyfried. She knocks it out of the park in this movie. You're probably going to show that Meryl Streep exists in this. Same with Pierce Brosnan, Colin Firth. Yeah.
Yeah, cut to her slightly better songs, because she's not good, but she's not the worst. And so there are definitely parts that you could kind of snatch. And she's got good backup. Mm-hmm. So if you pull from her back, like the ones where they're singing in a group, you can kind of hide some of her shortcomings.
You put in your Dancing Queens, your Mamma Mia reprise, all that sort of stuff where it's just like, oh yeah, we don't need to know that Meryl Streep is not the greatest singer in the world. So let's see that trailer. Roll that beautiful bean footage, Anthony.
Anthony.
Yep.
Every girl has a dream.
From the jump.
Wedding, and I want my father to give me away.
Look at my baby. Yep. Your whole
fun times.
Every They're family. Making it Amanda Seyfried's story, which it's really not, which is kind of interesting.
And I have three possible fathers. Oh my God.
Every wedding.
Which one did you invite?
All of them. Whoops.
New surprises. You always knew how to make an entrance.
Now, here's what's interesting. This is the Meryl Streep version of the song.
Yeah.
The last time I saw your mother.
Which you could have just played ABBA, but you know.
They're not highlighting any of the actual singing parts. They're just like, hey, look, this is the story of this musical.
Yeah, we're going to give everything away in 30 seconds. She was my favorite character. The little tiny one who wrote the cookbook.
What's her name? Julie Walters.
Yeah. She has more of a story in the movie than she does in the play.
They're playing... to my favorite ABBA song. This is it right now. Gimme, gimme, gimme. It's a great song.
Yeah. It is a great song.
Universal Pictures. And then you get to Dancing Queen.
Yep.
I've got three dads coming to my wedding, and I have to tell two of them are surplus, only which two.
This is about as perfect of a trailer as you can get for a movie like Mamma Mia.
Absolutely.
You're hitting the plot. You're showing Meryl Streep. You're showing Pierce Brosnan, Amanda Seyfried. You're showing all the eye candy. You're showing the three best ABBA songs in the movie. You're showing some fun dance sequences.
If I didn't know better, this trailer looks like a party. And yeah. I want to watch it. Yeah,
I
want
to go to this party.
Yes, absolutely.
Are we off? I used to have fun.
Oh, we know.
Yeah, that's fun.
See, that seems great.
Jeez.
But
yeah, the trailer does make it out to be great.
This is the real downside here, is that we get to see that happen, and then we see in the actual musical, in the movie, we get to see the stark differences between what's going on in the trailer as far as like the things they choose to highlight and the actual best parts of the movie as far as like performances go.
Yes.
Yeah. Like let's look at, and this is a clip you wanted to bring up. It's the Honey Honey clip. And sorry, I interrupted you, but what were you about to say?
No, this is, I think, the most effective. And to be honest, like when I started rewatching it just earlier today, in getting into this song, it does have a little bit of stage dialogue, which is, you know, a little more obvious than screen dialogue usually is, but it's excusable. And in going through these few scenes, I was like, did I misremember? Is this way better than I remember it being? Mm-hmm. And then it immediately derails. But this first scene gives you a ton of hope for the rest of the movie.
Yeah. Like after this, I was willing to grade it on a curve because I was like, well, they're doing the musical thing where they're like explaining everything in the very beginning. But honestly, I don't mind when a movie can get its plot out, because that's what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to get the driving force of the rest of the movie out in the first 15, 20 minutes of your movie. So if you can do it in the first 5 minutes, like a musical does, good job. I'm cool with
that.
Yeah,
we know within, I actually timed it out, 8 minutes and 14 seconds. We know exactly what's going to happen for the rest of the movie. Mm-hmm. We know that she's invited her dads. Her mom doesn't know. They think that the mom invited them and chaos is going to ensue. And we know that within, no kidding, 8 minutes.
Yeah.
And they actually did a really good job staging these scenes too, where you kind of run around the entire island. So it kind of gives you not only your basis for where the movie's going to go, but also a literal basis for the contained environment that we're kind of bottling all of these plot points up into.
Right.
Why there are so many young people on a remote Greek island, who knows? That's a question that never gets answered. But it's not that important. Yeah.
Let's see this clip. Let's see this song. Let's see Amanda Seyfried and company sing Honey, Honey.
That's here. That's Calicari.
We danced on the beach and we kissed on the beach and dot, dot, dot.
What?
Dot, dot, dot. That's what they did in the olden days.
Oh, stop it!
Sam's the one. I know he is. I've never felt like this before.
Honey, honey, how he thrills me. Uh-huh, honey, honey.
See?
Honey, honey, nearly yeah. kills me.
Seamless uh-huh, transition. Honey, honey. Well crafted.
I heard about him before.
Look at how
and she
well
is
this
the
is
best. Yeah, it's gorgeous. She's the best singer in the movie. Like, this is their best foot forward. And if the entire rest of the movie met the quality of this opening 8 minutes, it's a great movie.
Mm-hmm. Because you get to just see Amanda Seyfried and her gal pals, her bridesmaids, having fun, running around. I never heard this song before this musical, and I'm just like, oh, yeah. I'm on yeah. board. See? Anthony's in the booth right now, literally, like, bobbing his head back and forth. I see him. Because this is, yeah. as the kids say, a bop.
Yeah, very catchy.
But guess what?
All this time, Sam has been telling me he loves me.
Uh-oh.
And now he's announced that he's engaged, so he's gone home to get married, and I'm never going to see him again.
Problem.
I don't know. August 4th.
Mm-hmm.
What?
This is a great vehicle for exposition. Yeah. Absolutely.
Rented a motorboat and I took
and the
over
song
to
itself
island.
Doesn't have a lot of meat Sophie, to it, so they can really fill it in with I'm actual diary entries Sam. And information, mm-hmm. and we're not missing any of the song.
Right.
One thing led to another, and dot, dot, dot.
How they're so, singing it while running upstairs, I don't know.
Harry turned up out of the blue, so
that's some good editing or something right there. Now let's go ahead and cut here because we know what's happening.
Yeah, it's the same over and over.
Let's go from this to, let's go to Mamma Mia, the actual scene. Because this is a very different way that they're playing and using the song and using the actual performance of it. So let's, just for the context of people who might not have seen Mamma Mia, which by the way, just find it. It's fun. If you're down right now, it's on YouTube. Just go watch. You basically can roll through the movie clips playlist of this movie and understand exactly what's happening in Mamma Mia. You get it. You know what's going on.
In true musical fashion, 90% of this movie is sung. So if you just watch the songs, you've watched the movie, essentially.
So let's see this clips, because at this point, Meryl Streep has finally discovered that the three men who might be her baby daddy are all in the same room together at this hotel that she owns, and they're ready for this wedding, and she's freaking out about it.
I also love the way they show each of them, mm-hmm. and it's the modern day equivalent dressed as their like teenage equivalent, and it is upsetting.
It's not good. I don't like that.
No, it was a bad choice.
A weird device.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Weird. We don't need to see that.
Yeah. Unnecessary.
That's the only one that kind of works because it's so quick.
Yeah.
But I don't need to see Pierce Brosnan with a fucking American chopper mustache.
And I think you know when.
Yeah.
So see, I like the song. Like, I'm dancing to the song literally in my chair right now. But the sequence is just...
It's non-diegetic, which is different from the first one because no one else in the scene can actually hear it. As opposed to previously when she was singing to her friends. So this is almost like her internal monologue, which is an interesting way to use the song for sure.
Mm-hmm. But it's one of those things where you get Meryl Streep doing very big musical acting. Which you never get to see Meryl Streep doing. Meryl Streep probably, as soon as they approached her to do this movie, she probably was thrilled. Like, that's my hope, is that she, instead of having to play something subtle and well-acted, she gets to take her skills and throw them out the window and just be
and just
big
have fun
and gigantic and have fun.
To be honest, if they had dubbed everyone over with better singers, I feel like I'd be okay with the acting she's doing. And with just her in this role, it is honestly the singing that bothers me most of all. And, you know, seeing her have fun would be great, if not for the distractingness of the singing. But this, right. I think, is probably her best song in the movie. I would say that of the songs she sings, she does this one best. And I think it's because she can kind of slow it down and act it out, as opposed to trying to actually sing it the way the original is sung. If that makes sense.
Right. Because now, and we're really entering musical, magical realism territory where the monologue's happening, but you have this group coming in the background.
The Greek chorus, yes.
Yep, a literal Greek chorus. Oh my God.
A literal Greek chorus, yeah. There's a lot of that in this movie, actually, where the townspeople literally serve as like a Greek chorus for what is ostensibly a very Greek tale, if you want to think about it that way. Yeah.
So we can go ahead and cut here. Yeah. Now let's go to what I think is unfortunately the worst song of the movie and also the most unnecessary one, which is Take a Chance on Me.
Yes. And it is completely unnecessary and very uncomfortable.
Yeah.
And I want to say that in the play, it's in a different place as far as timeline goes in the plot. But I remember it being equally as uncomfortable. So right. I think it's just a weirdly placed song.
Yeah. Well, because the crux of this song in the movie and the actual plot line is this song is being played after the wedding at the reception. And Sam and Donna, so Pierce Brosnan and Meryl Streep have finally agreed to, they get married, they have this unrequited love, and then Colin Firth, you find out he's gay, and he's been gay the whole time, and
right,
which is a great reveal, by the way, because
it is a great reveal.
Where it's just, he literally has this line where he's like, you were the first woman I ever loved and the last woman I ever loved. And then it just cuts to him like making eyes with a handsome Greek man and they like wink at each other and they're like, anyway, so that's the end of our plot. Yeah. Let's move on. Let's see what's going on with Bill.
Well, and essentially they have to tie all the loose ends because we've introduced three potential love interests and we have to eliminate them so that we feel okay with her marrying Pierce Brosnan. And so Stellan Skarsgård has to be dealt with is essentially what
right.
this song is.
And the way they do it in the wedding, at least, is he's just like, nah, I'm fine. I'm a writer. I'm going to live on my own. And then she has a friend, Julie Walters, who's also a writer, who's like comfortable on her own.
Right.
They bond because she's just horny and old at this point, and she just wants to be tied
right.
down, I guess. She's just been lying to us the whole movie.
It's a very weird message because she's portrayed as this wonderful, actualized, independent woman. And then at the end, she's like, but really what I've been missing is a heteronormative relationship.
Right.
And yeah, so this idea that everyone has to be with someone is a very musical idea. And it was interesting that they still included it in the film.
Because
it's a little odd.
It feels like an afterthought. You can really end the movie after the wedding and just jump straight to the reprise of Mamma Mia, but instead we have this interloping scene, which is also one of the worst sung parts of the entire movie.
Yeah, and if I remember correctly from the play, the song takes place the night before the wedding, because in the play, I want to say, the wedding is essentially the end, and then they reprise Mamma Mia, and that
right.
is kind of how it goes. But I think maybe they thought that was weird with him, with Stellan Skarsgård essentially still becoming a love interest all the way up through the wedding.
Right.
Maybe.
Yeah. Let's play this clip.
Yeah.
Let's see how it winds up going out in the very end, actually.
Yes.
Lone Wolf.
Which is a callback. She called herself a lone wolf earlier.
If you change your mind.
I hate this.
He also looks 10 years older than both Meryl Streep and the other girl in the band.
Yes.
Like, I don't know how they have one friend that's 10 years older than them.
Honey, I'm still free. Take a chance on me.
Not a fan.
Nope. Nope.
Fan of what?
And she can...
I'm gonna be sorry, go ahead. What can she do?
I was gonna say, she's not a bad singer as far as the women go, especially when she gets into it, but it's so awkward that you can't even enjoy it.
Yeah. Because the actual way the scene plays out is what makes this song bad.
Yes. Yeah.
This is the equivalent of somebody proposing at your wedding. What's happening yes. right now?
Yes. Yes. And why everyone is so on board with it, I don't understand.
But because it's a musical, that's why everybody's got to be happy.
I guess. And she effectively is saying, like, I know you fucked my best friend back in the day, and up until, like, a couple minutes ago thought this girl was your daughter. May still be your daughter, but do you want to throw one in? Like, it's just real... It's a real jump, I think.
Yeah.
There's also
you throw it in.
Yeah. There's also no relationship with them prior to this, so it is literally like coin flip.
And this is ridiculous.
Yes.
How did they get to this position?
No one knows. It's like she's chasing him, kind of like in Pirates of the Caribbean, the ride where the women are chasing the men in circles. That's this song. Like, they're rolling off roofs and things, and he's like, no, I'm not going to save you because you're creepy. Like,
right.
It's the cartooniest song in this movie.
Mm-hmm. It takes me completely out of the entire... I really don't like this song in the movie. I like this song yeah. in general, but it's just, this feels so out of place and weird where it is in the movie.
Yeah. And as a comedian, I feel like it robs the movie of what could have been a very, very, very funny moment mm-hmm. at the wedding where he either reveals that he's like, much like Colin Firth revealing that he's been gay this whole time. It would have been equally hilarious for him to be like, oh, I have a family back home. They think I'm on a business trip. Like, anything but that. Or
right.
if they revealed that they'd been in love back in the day. Who knows? Any number of reveals at the wedding could have removed the need for that song and been an extra place for a joke, and we could have tied this movie up handily. But, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a weird addition. And it's not even the entire song. It's like a portion of a song that they felt that they needed to include for some reason.
Right.
So
now, to wrap things up, Paige, we both know that our point of view on movie musicals is, although different on Mamma Mia, we're coming from the same place. We know movie musicals are a yeah. hard thing to pull off. As much as Mamma Mia is a fun time, even if it is mm-hmm. bad with parts of it and miscast in some areas, I agree. I think it's fun. You think it's not worth a watch. What do you think is worth watching movie musical-wise? If you had to pick one movie musical to save out of the entire genre, what are you going with?
Out of the entire genre, I love West Side Story. It's probably my favorite.
I've never seen West Side Story.
I love West Side Story. And it is still very, I mean, it was filmed in the 60s. It is very, it has a lot of corny musical tropes, but I think it's one of the best ones just overall. Singing in the Rain is also pretty good. I would say anything before the 80s is mm-hmm. a decent musical most of the time
right.
from a movie standpoint.
Personally, I'm a big fan yeah. of The Music Man.
Music Man is fantastic.
Music Man's great.
I think. Recently, I loved Rocket Man. I thought Rocket Man was
I liked
great.
Rocket Man. Yeah. Rocket yeah. Man's fun.
And people don't think of it as a musical, but it is. It's presented almost like a musical.
Mm-hmm.
And I really liked Rocket Man. I also, I'm a Beatles nerd, so I enjoyed Across the Universe. It has its slow moments. It's got pacing problems. But from a visual standpoint, I think they did a pretty cool job.
Right.
Yeah, I would say those are probably my two more recent favorites as far as musicals go.
Interesting stuff. Well, go ahead. And I mean, we've done episodes on Rocket Man and Across the Universe as movies that people don't like.
I totally understand people not liking them. And they're not perfect movies. Across the Universe, especially.
Especially not.
It's got real Act 2 problems. For as cool as it is visually, story-wise, it's got issues. But I feel like it succeeds in some of the ways that this movie doesn't, where the music is done really well. Mm-hmm. But it's not as fun to watch, if that makes sense. I thought Rocket Man, it definitely also has some issues and some story issues, especially because it's a little biased in presenting factual information. But I thought they did a pretty good job.
Yeah. I mean, the person who I had on who didn't like Rocket Man didn't like it because it was actually a musical, and he's just not a musical person. So,
sense. But
yeah.
It's also Elton John. Like, you can't make a movie about Elton John and not have songs in it.
Right. You know? Exactly. Well, Paige, thanks so much. Honestly, legitimately, thank you for making me watch Mamma Mia. it was a real spot in my quarantine, and I appreciate
that.
I have
to watch the sequel now. I feel like I got to see what happened to the rest of the story and watch Mamma Mia 2.
Mamma Mia 2, here we go
the
again.
The Mamma Mia. Yeah, is it Here We Go Again?
It's called Here We Go Again. It's great.
Oh, that's terrible.
What a title. What a call. Paige, where can the listeners find you and your work if they want to get to know you a little bit more?
For sure. On Instagram, I am at Rampage Wesley, and on Twitter, I'm at Paige Wesley, or I've got my own show, Cult Podcast, where if you're super into cults, that's what we talk about. And that's at Cult Podcast Show on Twitter or Cult Podcast on Instagram. And then it's on all streaming platforms.
Cool. Yeah. Wherever you get your podcast, subscribe to that. And you can find me at Diet J on Twitter and Instagram. Subscribe to Blockbusting on Patreon if you want to support the show and get access to some movie goodies like movie watching time with me and my private movie and TV collection. Fun times.
Oh, hey.
J Flicks, baby. And thank you for being on, Paige. It was a real pleasure.
Yeah. Thank you for having me. This was fun.
This has been Blockbusting. Go see something good for a change. All right, that's it.